Thank you, Shreya, and a very good evening to our panelists as well as the audiences joining us today. A very warm welcome to IDC and IC Universal Legal hosted interactive session, The Mainstreaming of Alternatives. Yes, I'm your moderator today, and I'm personally thrilled to be moderating such a brilliant panel of ACE professionals in the ALTS. Before I start the discussion, I would definitely briefly introduce the panel. Ladies first. So the speakers for today, Shreya, if you can share the slide, lovely. Yeah, so going ladies first, joining us today is Lilavati Naidu, who is a partner with IC Universal Legal and oversees the firm's private funds and asset management and regulatory practice at its Mumbai office. Before joining IC Universal Legal, Lila was leading the compliance function at Avendus Capital for its asset management services, including offshore funds, AIFs, and PMS. She has a very unique recognition where she was recognized as one of the top 40 under 40 talent in alternative investment professionals in India by the AIWMI in 2020. Same year, she was recognized as 40 under 40, but for the compliance professional track, 10 by 10. Lila, it's wonderful to have you here. Our next speaker demonstrated winning in the new mainstream, Pramod Gubbi, founder and head of sales at Merciless Capital. With 8 years of stint in Ambit Capital, Pramod has served Ambit as managing director and head of institutional equities before he left. Pramod has also served as a head of Ambit Singapore office, having a very extensive offshore experience. He served in the Singapore office of Ambit in 2013 to 2016. Before joining Ambit, Pramod worked across sales and research functions at Clear Capital, a British equity research firm currently. As well as we all know, Pramod is head of sales in Marcellus and manages the sales and marketing efforts. Investments are not away and not out of its size ever. He also sits on the investment committee that discusses and approves investment strategies of the fund. Pramod, thank you so much for joining this panel. Lovely to have you here. Joining us next, my senior industry colleague, Umang, who is Executive Director and Chief Investment Officer at India Infoline Wealth. He has more than 2 decades of experience under his sleeves in the investments and wealth management space. At India Infoline Wealth, Umang provides strategic guidance for investment decisions across asset classes, including equities, real estate, fixed income, commodities, and alternatives, with a focus on continuous product innovation. Umang, thank you for joining us, and I'm sure we will all have lots of takeaway today.
Thanks, Jyoti. Thanks to IBC and ICL for inviting me. Thank you.
Our next speaker is the man who disrupted the space of alts from the word go. Nikhil Vora is the founder and the CEO of Six Sense Ventures, and with almost 30 years of experience under his belt in financial markets and the consumer domain. Nikhil was earlier the managing director and head of research at IDFC Securities, and has been regarded as one of the strongest analytical minds in the country. In fact, there has been a rarest distinction and recognition that came Nikhil's way, which was in Asia Money Polls in 2012. Nikhil was voted as India's best analyst. In fact, the same year, the rare distinction I mentioned, he was also voted as Asia's best analyst by the Wall Street Journal. Definitely a rare recognition for an Indian analyst on a global platform. Nikhil, thank you so much for making time for this panel. I know you've been running a very tight schedule.
Jyoti, it's a pleasure to be here. Thanks so much for inviting me.
Lovely. So moving on with our main track, I would just like to do a context setting before we move into our panel discussion. As we all know, India is lighting up global alt space. Once a widely radical idea, today alternatives have become an important vector of diversification for global and local investors. Today, 800 plus funds have registered. 100 plus are in the documentation process, which confirms that alt is only going to see more flows and investments, and alts will remain the main choice of investors in years to come. The sheer size of the industry, that's beyond 55 billion today, is showing no sign of slowing down. with assets soaring up under alts, I think we couldn't have thought of a better topic than discuss this today in length and breadth, the mainstreaming of alternatives in India. How does one of the oldest alternate managers feel about the journey? How new entrants look at the space? Time is of the essence. I will just quickly move to this exciting panel discussion. And just for our audience's information, this panel discussion is divided into four topics, and I will familiarize with each four topics as we move into. Opening up the first topic for the panel is journey so far. What has led to mainstreaming of alternatives? After all, it's good to take a detour to witness the journey of alts and feel a little nostalgic. We are in the last month of the year. New Year's is around the corner. It's a good time to reflect on the journey so far. I invite Umang to share his memory from the rear view. Umang, my first question to you, as a manufacturer of the alts right from the inception, some of you have literally set the runway for the new entrants to come in. My question is, once a polarized avenue of investments, what has made mainstreaming of alts a possibility? How has the landscape evolved from an asset manager's perspective? Umang, over to you.
Yeah, hi Jyoti, and hi everyone. I think a very good question to start with, Jyoti. So, it takes me back to memory lane way back in 2012, I think, when the regulations came in. And around early 2013 is when AIF started getting launched, right? Now, when I look back 8 years since this regulation, I think it's come a long way. And you said, you know, we've already have now more than 5 lakh crores in terms of assets. Now, two or three things which led, I think, are key to this industry explosion or explosive growth rather, is one was the regulations allowed us a lot of innovation. So it was initially and still is very light touch as compared to other licenses. So, you know, you can quickly innovate, start making products which are more relevant to the market. So a lot of us, me included, I think, came out with the products which the clients wanted. That was one. Second, I think structurally what's happened is interest rates have, come down to all-time lows, and it's supposedly going to be in this range for a long time. So when you don't get very high rates in fixed income, people obviously look for growth assets and some other alternative assets, and that has also led to this explosion. So just to put things in perspective, Jyoti, so 5 lakh crores, 5.5 lakh crores, that number which you mentioned. When you put in perspective to equity AUM of mutual funds, which is 13 lakh crores. So 13 lakh crores equity AUM has been raised since maybe, I'll not go back as 1964 when UTI was formed, but maybe in the early 90s when private sector came in mutual funds. So 30-year journey is 13 lakh crores in equity, not counting liquid and other fixed income, full fee-bearing assets. And we are already at 5 lakh crores in alternative assets. So I think it's a combination of regulations as well as low interest rates.
Perfect. I think that's truly setting the tone very clearly. Regulations allowed innovation. Absolutely correct. And the yield-hungry world is chasing the alts like never before. And I think India is just right to attract them. Thank you, Umang, for your points. My next question is going to be to Leela, because Umang, you mentioned something very interesting. The regulations have allowed innovation. And on that tone, of course, Leela, I would like to invite your views, because for any regime to stand the test of time and grow, regulations play a pivotal role. In your experience earlier as a head of compliance and now as a practitioner of law, does regulation take the cake for making alts mainstream?
Thank you, Jyoti, for this question. To again go back to the journey which Umang left, AIF is a very classic case study of a platform which has evolved from a collaborative effort of policymakers, industry participants, and investors. If I go back to the 1996 till 2012 era, when the VCF was being shifted to alternative investment funds, policymakers did make sure that a lot of consultative papers and feedbacks from the industry participants, this process of asking the industry players, what do they really want, has led to a creation of open architecture platform, which still continues. This framework has created an entire ecosystem of products, which Umang rightfully pointed out. You name it and we have it. Be it credit, be it private equity, be it infrastructure, real estate, stressed assets. This infrastructure is helping us plugging the gap between the funding and the utilization of funds at disposal. If you look at the recent regulatory changes like co-investments, angel investing, large accredited investors, having merchant bankers to fast track the PPM approvals, they all complement and sync in with the new requirements that the industry has been asking for. I personally believe if the regulators continue to balance between the stabilized regulatory regime and equally governed market, we have a long way to go. So they take all the cake and all the cherry on the topping.
Superb. Okay. That's setting the tempo really high, Leela and Umang. I love the points, Leela, that you mentioned that from a framework to an ecosystem, this growth is nothing but nothing short of becoming a case study, because they all have really come a long way. Now, the third question gets more interesting. That's coming to you, Nikhil. As you heard the previous two speakers, that when the opportunities like alts, yield-hungry world out there chasing yield, India providing them through alt assets. So when opportunity like alts are stitched effectively with regulations, it becomes a good recipe for its success. After all, the 5 lakh crore that assets under management that we are talking about is somewhere a barometer for the success of a segment. Nikhil, want to know your view as per you, why investors invested in alts in spite of its nascency of regulations at them? And in fact, you also launched your fund. So even at uncertain times, investors chose illiquid assets like alts. So what's your view on this?
So Jyoti, it's interesting. Umang talked about the environment side of it, which is the regulators, and Neela also talked about it a bit. I think the second part, and which is, I think, a more driving point, is investors getting a lot more savvier in their investment style and the investment behavior that you look at. You know, eventually, everyone's looking at alternate or any other investment class to generate more delta and more alpha in their own portfolio. To me, the fact of the matter is that, you know, if you look at Fortune 500 companies in 1980s and look at the same names today, 90% of companies have died or become irrelevant over a decadal cycle, which fundamentally means that even if you are amongst the best endowed companies in the world, which is, you know, be it in terms of scale, capability, management, execution, capital, revenues, profits, you are still destined to be fail over a decadal cycle. To me, the Fortune 500 example is quite equivalent to what listed market will be in India or is in India, which means that legacy leaders very rarely can remain leaders for a perennial period of time. And fundamentally, investing is all about investing in future leaders. And future leaders, if they are there, they're getting born today. And if they're getting born today, they're in private domain. And that's why a venture fund or a private fund now incrementally makes a lot more sense in India, where you believe that leadership role will get challenged over the next decade and so on. So while the environment has obviously been far more conducive, it's also the fact that I think investors have also in their own judgment become a lot more sharper in the outlook and the way they think about this. And alternate thereby has actually become more mainstream than what you've seen for the last 4 or 5 decades. And that's also the reason why, like Umang gave some numbers on the public market or mutual fund investing versus alternate. I have no real doubts that alternates will become a larger asset class in the next 3 to 5 years than mutual funds today. And that's a fair ask to go with. Second aspect is, what was inhibiting alternates so far, if that was one, was one is illiquidity or the perceived illiquidity of alternate market. And second, frankly, is also about the non-deliverance of returns by private fund managers like the 3 of us who are sitting here in some form. And I'm just giving this as an anecdotal reference. The fact is that 70% of alternate fund managers have not returned money back during the tenure of the fund, which is an extremely poor statement to make till date or till yesterday. I think that will change quite significantly as we move forward. And that will also lead to a lot more excitement from investors to look at alternate as an incremental asset class to add to, which they were not really looking at earlier. Exits, to me, is the least of the concern, frankly. And I'm saying this in the construct that, you know, if business cycles earlier were possibly around 30 to 40 years, incrementally, successful business life cycles are moving to 10 to 15 years, which also means that cycles are moving shorter, that means that if businesses deliver, they deliver a lot more in a shorter period of time, and thereby the returns are also in a very short period of time. And thereby the ability to exit is a lot more faster than what you've seen before. So I'm not too worried about exits. I think there are multiple exits available. There are multiple layers of investors available, strategic players, IPO, or deeper investors, and so on. So I don't think alternate or exits are so much of a concern. I think returns are, and hopefully that's something which is changing quite drastically as we speak now. So I do believe that there's a lot more excitement to alternates from here on than what you've seen before.
Perfect. Well, thank you, Nikhil. I think a very different perspective coming from you, that of course, the bottom line is investments is all about investing in future leaders. And that's the job of the asset manager to find out the best ones to pick. Besides that, investor themselves has demonstrated good know-how about alts as an asset classes, and they and illiquidity is not something that truly is the feature of alts. It needs to be read differently. Thank you, Nikhil, for that point. I'm moving my last question for this section to Pramod. Pramod, you are literally a late entrant to the party, but yet you are a super successful one. And you have demonstrated winning in the new mainstream. Your choice of setting up an AIF3 and investing in public market is a well-appreciated stand. What, as per you, is leading the investors to move to alts in the listed public space when they can do it with conventional investment avenues? Pramod, your experience in this, please.
Right, thank you. Thanks, Jyoti. So I'll give it a public markets perspective. Of course, a lot of the factors apply to public factors, which Umang and Nikhil have already shared. But I'll share factors which are specific to our experience. And in our view, from my perspective, alternatives includes PMS and AIFs, because that's really at the high end of the ticket size. With 50 lakhs for the PMS now, it's not too far off for the AIFs. It's literally playing into that HNI investor space. There are two forces at play. Both are fairly structural and perhaps era defining, some of which will affect and help the mutual funds also. The first force is on the liability side, or where we say where the source of funds are. And that's where India is seeing perhaps one of the strongest financialization of savings waves that the world has ever seen. India has historically been short in terms of allocation to financial assets from a household savings perspective. I think there was this landmark report by the RBI in 2017, which put that number at something like 5%. Barely 5% of India's household savings is in financial assets. The 95% is in real estate and gold. And the best part is, contrary to popular perception, we would think that the high net worth community would have a slightly higher share. It isn't any different in any part of the socioeconomic strata at all. Even high net worth individuals have been fairly short in terms of allocation to financial assets. Somewhere in the last 10 years, that historical affinity to real estate and gold seems to have broken. Rightly or wrongly, rightly from an economy's perspective, allocation to financial assets are more productive uses of capital where businesses and entrepreneurship can flourish. So we have taken the turn, and our sense is that's likely to continue for the next several decades, because we're still significantly below where other emerging markets of similar per capita GDP levels are. So this is a multi-decadal trend, and that's likely to drive financialization as a whole. It's not just alternatives. Pretty much all facets of financial services will benefit from it. But like I said, even the high net worths are significantly under-allocated. That means that alternatives will drive. That's the driver from the source of fund side. From the deployment of fund side, also there are structural changes which are driving a move towards alternatives. Specifically from our perspective, what we're seeing is significant consolidation of the Indian economy into the hands of a few players. Industry after industry is getting consolidated. And it's nothing new. We've seen this trend in other economies, be it America in the early part of the 20th century, or Japan post-World War II, or Korea after the Korean War. Consolidation is a natural trajectory of evolution of the economy. As India has invested in, say, the road network, the highway network has doubled in the last 20 years. telecom penetration is pretty much 100% today. And under this government, we've also seen that pretty much every family in the country has a bank account, as opposed to barely one in three, even as recently as 6-7 years ago. So we literally network the economy significantly. Add to it the path-breaking legislation around GST, and now the role of technology. And technology would also drive in favor of the larger companies in every sector who can literally deploy technology, amortize technology spends across a larger scale of business, as opposed to the mom and pop shop, which means that there will be fewer and fewer companies dominating every sector, which means that the investable universe is going to get crunched. Of course, there'll be new industries that will come up, but within industries, you won't be able to build a diversified portfolio. The traditional funds was building diversified equity portfolios, which no longer play to the appeal of sophisticated high net worth individuals. And therefore, they're demanding slightly different strategies and also slightly different fee structures, which the traditional funds are not able to offer. So both on the demand side, the financialization of savings, and the fact that you will need to see more innovative, sophisticated strategies, even in the public market space, some of which are outside because mutual fund regulations, for example, are fairly constrained, rightly so, because the regulator's job is to protect the retail investor. On the other hand, the accredited investor is aware of some of these risks and is more than happy to demand these sort of strategies from alternative fund managers. And that's what we are appealing to. We run concentrated strategies across all our products. And we've been lucky to see success very early days, nothing to do with us. Like I said, these two forces amongst a few of the others that Nikhil and Umang mentioned have been driving. So it's more of a case of the right time, right place for us.
Super, exactly. Right time at the right place is the best that we can all ask for ourselves. Amazing points, Pramod. I think all of you have given such spectrum of insights in the first section of discussion itself, and a very refined insights coming out, and very important point, Pramod, you mentioned of financialization of the savings. That is a big vector that will move extremely favorable for our economy. And I completely resonate that there is aggregated investors which are well informed and they are making informed decisions. And there are opportunity both for private market investment houses as well as the public market. And very well laid out, Pramod. And that brings me to our next section of our panel discussion, where we're going to deep dive on fundraising, deployment, and exits as an important vector for making alts mainstream. What do our speakers think about fundraising, their experience on deployment and exits? Nikhil gave a trailer that he's not worried on exits. So let's see what he is worried on. Nikhil, my next question to you is, of course, we all agree that we have never seen an amazing time for a fundraising from a startup point of view and a GP view as well before. For a fund like yours that believes in perform, deliver, and exit mantra, I have two small questions for you. With your track record in fundraising, which seems to be quite a successful one, which pool of investors are investing from the domestic side and how the pie is getting bigger? So one is the question on domestic pool of investors. And yes, since you already answered, no challenges and exit. So I will change the question.
So I think a couple of things. Like you rightly said, it's about raising capital, performing, delivering, and exit. That's pretty much the life cycle that you're looking at. My sense is in raising capital, if you look at that as one lead play, there's also a need to do things right and fair. And it's not really about incentivizing investors, but doing the right things at any point in time. So I'm a big believer of the 0% theory, 0% management fee. The legacy Indian or global private equity venture funds have been running businesses on a 220 structure pretty much across the world, 2% management fee, 20% carry, irrespective of the performance of the fund. Now, to me, it's almost like, there's almost no penalty for bad performance in a structure like 220, which to me is extremely bizarre. So we did launch the first 0% management fee structure in a VC fund that was launched. And I think that's really the right way to do. It's about saying that, do you have enough skin in the game? Do you have enough belief in what you're trying to do? And are your incentives aligned to what the investors' alignment should be in terms of returns and so on? So I think that's one thing to ensure that you are able to raise capital in a most ethical manner and a very fair manner to go with. Yeah. Second is obviously about performance delivery and exits and so on. I think, you know, hopefully more than what we've done, and we've done a decently okay job so far in a short period of time. But I think, you know, India really provides that environment today for all of us to out-deliver quite disproportionate. The fact is that entrepreneurship in India is almost at an all-time high in terms of the way entrepreneurs are. I think the second is that there is really no mortal fear of leaders or challengers taking on leaders. I think that's a big, big difference that you're seeing today to what was there earlier. And specifically in a consumer universe, which is where our investments are significantly dedicated, I think there's really no mortal fear of taking on legacy. And the big differentiator, which earlier was about distribution and supply chain, I think that is getting cracked completely. So I do believe that there'll be a lot many disruptors who will challenge incumbents and leaders, and thereby they'll create their own space in the marketplace and so on, and thereby create great value also. So I do believe that there's really, in terms of ability to raise capital, I think quite disproportionate. To give you a sense, Jyoti, our first fund, which was in 2016, we were a 120 crore fund, pretty smallish in the overall scheme of things. And we just started our life journey there. And we had no experience of external capital management. Our second fund was 500 crores plus. Our third fund, which is the current fund, we were looking at raising 900 crores plus a green shoe of 600. So a 1500 crore fund at peak. We've crossed 2500 crores as we speak. And all this capital has been raised by domestic money. It's all rupee money. There's no dollar flow into this, which is very indicative of the fact that domestic appetite for alternates or investing early stage is of an extremely high order. And I do believe that there's a lot of big movement that you're seeing in the quality of investment also. Earlier, the investment would be, frankly, significantly HNI capital or family capital and so on. Today, that capital has become institutional capital, HNI capital, family money, but also balance sheet money, corporate treasuries investing behind alternate asset, which is a very rare thing to happen. It fundamentally means that alternate has become mainstream for corporates. And you know, normally corporates don't manage treasury by investing in external capital, external FOFs, in so to speak, in some form. They're doing this because they also realize that legacy businesses cannot create businesses on their own. They cannot create new opportunities on their own because that's not their DNA. It's not their zone to really create opportunities on their own. And the only way they can participate is through investing in a fund structure like ours, which comes in early in a lot of businesses, which are fundamentally investing in leaders of tomorrow. And if they are leaders of tomorrow, they're getting born today and thereby invest in the private domain and see their journey for the next 2-3 years and then possibly look at whether they need to be in that space, possibly look at strategically acquiring those businesses or being part of that journey in some form. So I see a significant changeover in the capital flows that one has seen in venture funds specifically to what you've seen possibly till yesterday, literally. So I think that changeover is becoming a lot more dominant. And that I think is a great sign because it also means that legacy is saying that they cannot compete with the next gen entrepreneurs or next gen players. And they need to collaborate, participate, and maybe at some stage look at integrating them in the fold.
Lovely. So thank you, Nikhil. In fact, some of the very amazing points that have come is, of course, disruption is your second name, if I may say so. So you are looking at ways of disrupting, and you have done a very disruption in the different spheres. And Pramod also highlighted about performance fees and other fees that the fund managers charge to the investors. So I get it from where you're coming, Nikhil. I would like to also understand, because Nikhil, you mentioned about the euphoric fundraising that is happening. So you are in a way, it's literally endorsing the previous four views of the speakers. Umang speaking, if 13 years it took for mutual funds to garner equity assets, I think it will, ALTS is definitely going to be there very soon. Then ALTS coming out as a case study in itself because of robust acceptance of this as an asset class. Pramod spoke about, you know, financialization of savings. So I think collectively we are confirming that the domestic pool is here to stay and it's only increasing. And thanks to the funds that are coming out. Pramod, my next question to you is something very interesting you mentioned earlier was that our responsibility is beyond generating returns. And we were talking about equity as an asset class, Pramod, when you mentioned. My question to you on this section of our discussion is that we have spoken a lot of, about polarization of equity and, you know, investors are looking at diversifying. What's in your view has worked in the investment sphere? Because the familiarization with the strategy, or are you seeing altogether different strategies emerging? Are long short the same favorite, still the favorite, Pramod?
No, I mean, in our view, you know, there is a structural limitation to shorting in India. We're perhaps one of the world's illiquid top 10 markets. Compared to our market cap size, our liquidity is very, very low. So particularly in derivatives beyond the top 50 names, I think shorting has a structural constraint in terms of liquidity. Therefore, long short by definition will be a smaller part of the alternative space. And that's the sort of demand we are seeing from investors as well. Most of them will be long only. Even the handful of long short will be long biased. Partly because of the structural constraint. Having said that, I think you know, you mentioned a point about you know, responsibilities beyond that. I think that's a very, very important fact for us, all of us, to realize, not just in terms of giving ourselves the satisfaction that we've been doing the right thing, but that's actually a path to success as well, which is what investors also appreciate. Because at the end of the day, all of us are intermediaries between the saver of capital and the user of capital. The saver being, whether it's a household saver or a government or a corporate, and the user of capital, again, similarly, you could be a government, corporate, or so all intermediaries have a fiduciary duty to ensure that you optimize the space in between the two, which is your presence should ensure that the return of for the saver is higher than what would have happened had you not existed. And on the other hand, you reduce cost of capital for the user of capital. Unfortunately, our industry worldwide has done exactly the opposite. And therefore, I think it is of paramount importance for each one of us, whether we are in wealth management, asset management, brokers, insurers, et cetera, to ensure that we are adding value through that. And that could be through better allocation of capital, which in some ways is also a primary duty of us. Right? We have immense power to influence capital allocation in this country. And as we know, India has historically been a capital constrained economy. For now, we are seeing this financialization. And therefore, it is our duty to ensure that capital goes into the right hands. So picking up the right promoters, picking up the right entrepreneurs, not just in terms of capability, but also in terms of ethics is far more important. And it goes beyond beyond our duty in terms of generating returns. And in terms of what's worked for us, I guess some of these aspects which we've lived by and we tend to articulate time and again, we don't fall shy of that. And that's appealed to a large segment of investors. In fact, investors generally want to deal with you know, people who they can trust. And if you can establish through your portfolio construction that you are deploying capital in companies which are clean with high levels of governance, then investors tend to lean towards you. I'm not saying that we are the only ones doing it, but because you brought up that point, I think it is important to say, by doing the right thing, you can also succeed. In addition to that, I think Nikhil mentioned a couple of points. The transparency, we have a duty towards our investors. We have been extremely vocal in terms of articulating our investment philosophy, try to make it as simple as possible. Investing at the end of the day is simple, right? Identifying businesses or understanding businesses is simply common sense. So unnecessarily, a lot of our peers have tended to make it very complicated, make it seem like a black box. But I think if you can articulate simply what's your investment process, you can let the investors evaluate you basis how you stick to that investment process. Because returns, as we all know, are not replicable into the future. So that articulation transparently of the investment philosophies work for us. Similarly, we've been from day one disclosing our portfolios to our clients. Historically, I think they've been funds which disclose on a quarterly basis or anything, but we disclose it on a real-time basis. That also builds trust amongst investors. And finally, we are extremely prolific in terms of investor communication. We write monthly newsletters, which are very detailed in terms of not just about the performance and stuff. So what's happening in the companies, even if things are going bad, we say it as we see it. And we combine that with monthly webinars. Our clients participate quite actively. They have access to our fund managers who tend to answer questions quite openly and transparently. All these webinars are recorded and put up on our website with no paywall. And that, I think, also has appealed to investors when it comes to our instance. And finally, I think Nikhil talked about the zero management fee. We are big fans of that approach because ultimately investors also want to see skin in the game. They've seen enough fund managers working for salaries and bonuses. But at the end of the day, they want to see that you're earning your fees because you're delivering the returns that you committed to. And that clearly was a differentiator when we launched. So, it's been just 3 years. We managed close to about 12,000 crores now, 9,000 in PMS and 3,000 in AIFs. Large part of that is because of the strong financialization wave that we're seeing. A small part of that is some of these transparencies that we offer, which has appealed to investors.
Okay. Pramod, thank you so much. You have really helped getting a lot of important perspective out. And yes, not everybody seems to be a fan of disruption, but when it happens, people do make a note. So I'm sure we all have made note of disruptions that you guys have carried, and it's been carried by Nikhil and his avatar, and it continues. I'm moving on this client centricity towards servicing, transparency, disclosure, and financialization of assets. I'm tempted to ask this question to Leela. Leela, my next question is to you, where I'm driving inspiration from Pramod as well. We are talking about sharing information with investors and giving them clarity, local or global. But speaking of global investor, for the benefit of global investors, AIFs are now in India, and now with the introduction of ALTS regime in IFSC in GIFT City, there has been a bit of question in the mind of global investors. Is it a dual opportunity, or should it be interpreted as confusion? So Leela, could you please share some insights for the global investors here?
Thank you, Jyoti, for this question. This is a bang on dual opportunity, Jyoti. I would say this is an extension of the phrase make in India to manage in India. We have amazing fund managers like Nikhil and Pramod and team who have been managing funds, and we have the best brains behind investment. But offering this benefit of fund management services to global investors have been difficult due to OM risk, uncertainty on tax implications. While we have alternative avenues like 9A and eligible fund regime, which was opened up, there are a few takers of it, but it has really not taken off because of the stringent conditions that the Indian fund managers have to meet and comply with. So Global City is an answer. GIFT City is like an answer to these questions to global investors who are looking to access India, but through a very lean route and not having to go through a complicated procedure of FDIs and FPIs. So for example, you have no PAN requirement for offshore investors, which is such a big boon to these investors, because the moment you take PAN, you are opening up to a tax assessment, which investors are not comfortable with sharing at all. So these small benefits which GIFT City has been passing on, including the tax clarity for the 10 years, they are not uncertain as to what exactly will happen in the next year when the budget comes. They are not waiting for February to wait and watch how will their income be treated. This is going to be an amazing opportunity. We already have 30 AIFs which are lined up in GIFT City. If you talk to any of the IFSC officials, they are super busy approving these applications and many more to come. I think the fund structure is going to grow manifold with global GIFT City coming into picture.
Sure. No, of course. Thank you, Leela. That's really helpful, because it keeps coming up whether to go for AIF in the in this onshore India regime or IFSC. So thanks for clarifying that. My next question is to Umang. Umang, you wear a lot of hats. My first question to you was from asset manager's perspective. This question is from the investor's perspective. Umang, you heard our other speakers. We are seeing industries seeing the robust inflows, both domestic as well as global. Nikhil literally raised the whole amount out of domestic pool of investors. My question is on moving away from domestic and global. what's making alternates so desirable among institutional players, which I'm sure by all means are extremely sophisticated and very picky about their allocations. Can you just give me that perspective for our listeners?
Yeah, sure. Okay. So what we've seen, and I think Nikhil did touch upon that initially. So I think in terms of alternatives going mainstream, there are two or three things which, they're going beyond convention. So when I look at Pramod and look at the listed parts, so for instance, let's look at that as an example. And when you have mutual funds becoming, so each scheme becoming say 30,000 crores or something like that, it's very difficult for a fund manager to be very nimble footed, when you're managing a scheme of that size. So what's happening between the institutions, say, for example, in the listed equity side, is that they will regard a mutual fund as a relative return product, and they will go towards absolute return or, very high amounts of alpha to people like Pramod. Right. So that's how the distinction is happening. So let's look at maybe if you call family offices as institutional as well, although they are not relatively can be called as institution. But let's say, take that for an example. Now, how has this money come about in the last decade is by selling their stakes in businesses through the journey, entrepreneurial journey, which they did over the last decade or 20 years. Now they want to give back to the society and or give back to budding entrepreneurs and saying that, okay, why don't you build businesses, right? So that the change. So when you look at the flow versus the stock. So when I say flow of wealth, the flow of wealth has been relatively through successful stake sales or business sales vis-a-vis old traditional wealth. So these investors, whether they're institutions, whether they are family offices or large HNIs in themselves, they want to do different kind of investments. They want to invest and support other entrepreneurs, like say, come too early as angel investors or come in between the journey of the entrepreneur. And that is what a key change we're seeing, at least in the last 7 to 8 years. Fair. So that, and maybe now, even if you look at yield, so for instance, even institutions want yield as far as their corporate treasuries or portfolios are concerned. And if you're getting only 5% or 6%, the treasury is kind of motivated to go into, say, a road asset or a solar yielding asset or a rental yielding property where you get 7 to 8% plus capital appreciation, which is not possible in a bond. So these things are changing, and that's what we've been seeing over the last 7 to 8 years.
Thank you, Mang. Great. I'm going to change the gears quickly so that we can accommodate maximum questions. Nikhil has already answered one of the questions that is on challenging in fundraising. He doesn't face any challenges at all. So I won't ask him that question. Moving to the section three, which is going to be covering regulations and meeting investors' rising demand for transparency and good of governance. This section is going to be a quick one. And my first question is to Pramod. Pramod, you mentioned about being proactive in sharing information like portfolios and other details with the investors promptly and regularly. While we have, from what I collate is that while there is an inherent opaqueness that becomes sometimes a challenge for investors in the private market, of course, there are other, I won't say challenges, but there are sometimes issues with regards to valuations, and exits sometimes could be a little sticky. But Pramod, in your case, it's mark to market on daily basis. What kind of a rising demands you see, if not transparency from your investors, but what are the other demands that you see from investors with regards to investors wanting more insights on the investment styles and things like that? Do you face any challenge here, Pramod?
No, not really. I think we have led from the front here in terms of changing some of the paradigms in the industry. And remember, I think if you think from first principles, people are giving you their hard-earned money. The least you can do is offer transparency and earn their trust. All right. So I don't think they should be demanding. You have a duty to deliver that to them. So like I said, this is not for the sake of doing it or because it sounds nice. it actually wins over customers and leads you to the path of success. So even if you were to think, but unfortunately, like I said, our industry has been exactly the opposite way. And it's not just in India, across the world, right? We're supposed to be custodians of our clients' wealth, and we've done quite a bit to destroy a lot of that. I think Nikhil mentioned the percentage of funds which couldn't even return the money. I mean, that's abysmal. Now, some of these factors could be outside even the best investors' control, right? Market cycles are outside. There will be business failures and stuff. Often, opacity, what it does to investors, it starts doubting you, right? If you're transparent, even if you're going through a rough patch, investors are likely to stick with you, right? So that's, again, the recipe for success rather than a nice-to-have thing. So I don't think regulations should drive any transparency. It should come from the fund manager. And given the free market nature of our economy now, investors will figure out. I think investors will back those funds which are standing for transparency and will run away from those who've been shy of this, who've been guilty of this. So you don't need any regulatory help. If at all, I think regulators, we request regulators to be cognizant of the fact that alternative space are meant for accredited investors. So you should be giving far more leeway to be able to manage more sophisticated strategies. I think the investor protection duty should lie at the mass market level where you're regulating mutual funds, maybe index funds and so on. Investors are coming to alternatives because they are aware of potential risks here, and therefore they should be able to benefit from those flexibilities, which is why I think Umang made a fantastic point. The industry will sort of migrate into two different ends. It's the barbelization, which is happening globally as well, including institutional investors. For exposure to the market or beta, they go towards index funds or passive funds. If they want alpha, they would want more sophisticated strategies through alternatives, concentrated strategies, and so on. And that's where regulations should recognize. That's where the investor demand lies. And you have your investor protection regulations more closely to the mass retail end, whereas give more flexibility for alternatives to cater to the sophisticated demands of high net worth investors.
Fine, absolutely, Pramod. You highlighted some of the very pertinent points here, and in fact, that connects me to the next question, which I'm going to ask Leela. Leela, you heard Pramod with regards to, you know, to win in the to remain and win in this game, to service the investors with utmost transparency is not out of force. It's truly coming out from the asset managers to keep investors updated about the investments taking place and the subsequent returns. But somewhere regulator does end up tightening forcing at times. This is what the industry feedbacks comes at all the time. But from a legal and regulation standpoint, Leela, hasn't regulator done over tightening in your views, or it's just the fine balance that regulator is trying to make? How do our alt regulations compare to VCC in Singapore and ICAVs in Europe? Leela, over to you for your views, please.
Very interesting question, Jyoti. Having set up funds in all the three jurisdictions, India has a very unique regulatory regime. For example, overseas, investment management is a specialized activity in itself. It is a licensed activity. The fund in itself is a different licensed activity. In India, the entire stress of managing the fund, AML, KYC, operations service falls on the investment manager, while globally, it is on the fund. And specialized people just do the specialized activities. This raises all the stress from the investment manager who do what they are specialized in. If I have to compare between all the three regimes, VCC, ICAVs in EU and Ireland, India still continues to be a very light touch regime when it comes to compliances and transparency. As you begin the session saying that we have 800 AIFs who are already registered, hundreds again coming in, and it's going to increase manifold over a period of time. We have hit the 5 trillion mark. This enormous pace at which AIF is growing, the quantitative aspects have been met. It's been like in 2022, AIF regulations will complete a decade, and we have hit the $5 trillion mark already. So this quantitative aspect is complied with. Now the regulator for the last 10 years have been observing the growth pattern, the investor grievances. A lot of SEBI inspections have started with many AIFs. There have been a lot of observations coming out of it. In the second phase of growth, which is the next decade that we are looking for, the focus will now shift to the qualitative aspects of robust governance disclosures. We have fund managers on our panel today who have been very proactive and have been doing that. And I think that the moment the industry shifts to a very proactive transparency, to a proactive compliance and disclosures to the investors, the regulators don't have to do much about it. I think we are not ready for another VCF debacle, and it's high time that more industry participants like Nikhil, Pramod, they actually gear up and pull up their socks. We don't need tightening of regulations at all.
Okay, Leela, fantastic.
That's quite a big relief, by the way, coming from Leela, that you don't require tightening, over-tightening. I think that's really fairly put. I hope that's actually what you mean also.
Absolutely, we need more fund managers like you so that compliance officers and the lawyers like you don't have to say, okay, do this, don't do this. I think that's a very good feedback that I'm getting for you guys. It's like there are so many good fund managers out there wanting to do something for the investors. That's an amazing tree to look for.
Absolutely, Leela. Well laid out, Leela. And I think just like the regulator, you have delicately handled this topic. And I hope what you mentioned about $5 trillion literally happens, you know, in the AI space, in that context. So my next section is on crystal gazing, and I'm going to really move quickly because so that I can take up a rapid fire round towards the end. My first crystal gazing question into the road ahead is to promote the what do you think? How will listed market play out in the coming years? And which new asset class you think is likely to come in the private market space that will be under rolls?
Well, I mean, like I said, I can talk about the public markets place.
My question is on public market. Sorry, this hangover of private market is you know, blame it on Nikhil.
Right. So again, here, if you're asking for market levels, I don't think I'm qualified to contribute, you know, comment on that. Markets, by definition, at least in the short term, are unpredictable and increasingly so, given the sort of world that we're living in. They're bound to be things. So I wouldn't even hazard guessing where the market level will be. But I think there are some underlying forces in the economy which are structural and which are quite positive and very conducive for entrepreneurship because of the ease of access to capital for more reasons than one. Leaving aside the global interest rate regime, we don't know. We don't know when rates will go up, but I think the financialization means that there'll be more entrepreneurs who will get easy access to capital, which will drive its own productive activity within the economy, which in turn will have trickle-down effects on perhaps the most dire need in our country as of now. I mean, the statistic which we read in the newspapers every 3 months that 80 crore Indians are still being given free food by the Prime Minister during the COVID regime, and it's been extended every 6 months, right? I mean, it is an appalling statistic to even read. So I think the primary duty here for anybody involved, whether you're running the country or you're allocating capital, is to figure out a way to lift those 80 crore people out. I don't think we can afford to have 57% of our countrymen having to rely on the government for welfare schemes and so on. So I think allocation of capital will drive significant upliftment out of poverty, which in turn will drive consumer demand because these people will be able to afford certain goods and services for the first time. So the runway for growth for most products and services in this country is fairly long. I always cringe when I hear some people saying this product is penetrated, that market is saturated. I think you should read the statistic that people are still relying on the government for free food. How can the market be saturated? So if we can drive efficient capital allocation between the financial services community and if we can lift people out of poverty, I think the economic growth prospects for India will remain fairly long. In fact, India will remain the only large economy with these sort of growth prospects. Given that, I think the challenge will be the other way around. The challenge will be because India will be the only place with these sort of growth dynamics, you will have the best of companies from across the world entering India. So for fund managers like myself and Nikhil, the challenge is to figure out what sort of businesses can withstand that competitive entry, because competition is going to be even more intense as the West pretty much slows down with aging. Even China is now, as you know, aging. So India will remain the only young, large, poor economy where growth is abundant. So there are plenty of prospects, whether it's private markets or public markets. So public markets will also see the benefits of this economic growth as businesses will see significantly longer growth runways and therefore higher and higher valuations, provided they can build these competitive advantages to face off the incoming competition. That's the real question to answer.
Perfect. No, Pramod, thank you so much. I knew it's you who can literally change and modify this question and present it in much better than fantastic. So we'll quickly move. I just want my next speakers to be brief so that we can accommodate questions coming in from the participants as well. Leela, one question that has come we have put this into crystal gazing is everybody is asking about the ESG integration with you. Brief view on this. Should industry be really ready for the ESG integration with ALTS?
Globally, Jyoti, ESG is a very well-recognized theme. You already have $32 trillion industry under the ESG, and it's soon going to hit by 2025, $50 trillion industry. So the next generation of investors that we're talking about and the new set of fund managers who are already with us, they're already integrating it. So it should not be. So as rightfully said during our last discussions, every good thing doesn't need to be regulated. But if it is self-imbibed, it opens up a lot of opening of funds into the system. You have a lot of untapped funds like the provident funds, pension funds. Globally, this industry has started opening up to ESG as an investing theme. The more and more fund managers imbibe this theme, I think it's going to get into amass wealth by getting inflows from these industries.
Okay, so don't wait for the regulator's cue. Just go and adopt. Yes. ESG integration is definitely going to happen.
Yeah, and the next generation of people, which is the next generation after us, they're so socially aware about sustainability, environment friendly. This is the generation which is going to go for a conscious investing as a theme. That's going to be an era in itself when these investors will be conscious about where are the fund managers deploying, which is a type of industry the fence is getting into, whether it is environmentally helping, whether it is ethical, whether it's social. So conscious investing along with ESG is going to be a next big theme.
Thank you, Leela, for that, because we are moving. I'll just quickly move to a rapid fire questions. Before that, Nikhil, there's a question from our participant addressing to you. What is the Indian Family Office participation in PEVC? While you briefly touched this answer, Nikhil, but overall pie, how does the family office is responding to investments in the PE and VC space? If you can answer this.
So if I can just roll back to what Leela just said, on the ESG investing, I just have a point of view that, it's not about fund managers driving ESG. It's about consumers saying that this is the way we are going to consume, and thereby funds starting to actually invest behind companies which are really targeting that sort of a consumer base. So I think it's really going to be the other way around, rather than investors like us trying to, or company funds like us really investing in. It's really not so predominant about Pramod or me or anyone else trying to invest and get deeper there. It's about consumers saying that this is where we are going to do it, and thereby us as investors really looking at businesses which will evolve in that. So I think that will really become center stage. Second was about family offices and stuff. I can share our own experience. We've raised 2,500 crores, and which is almost a lock-in capital for 7 years in some form, because that's a fun life that we look at. Like I said, there's been a lot of corporate balance sheet which has also got invested this time around. I would say non-institutional and non-HNI capital has been almost to the tune of 35% of our cap in the current fundraise that we've done. So almost 800 to 900 crores has come from family offices, including corporate treasury, which I think is a fab number, because, and it's still almost, you're touching the surface, literally. I do believe that this crazy amount of capital which India has. And unlike in the past where, we would think that dollar money is obviously extremely large and sticky also. I think I would not be too far to say that rupee capital is as large, maybe not as sticky, but rupee capital is as large as any other capital that you've seen. So, and I think it's really emerging there now. And again, like Pramod said, that it's our fiduciary responsibility to to ensure that investors who trust businesses like ours or fund managers like ours, I think as long as that trust factor remains, transparency level is high. I think there'll be a lot more convergence that you'll see of domestic capital investing behind domestic funds like ours, like Pramod's, like Umang's and so on. I think that will become disproportionate to what we've seen till date. The reliance of Indian private equity or venture funds to rely on dollar capital and not so much rupee capital, I think that will, over a period of time, become, the skewness will actually become a lot less than what we've seen till date.
Thank you, Nikhil. That was quite a roundup coming from you. We have a few minutes, lifeline given by IVCA, and I'm just going to quickly ask you a few rapid questions. My first rapid question is coming to Umang. Many people have asked this question on your views of alts. Will alts glare at mutual fund by 2030? You have answered this question, but for the audience, do you think they will be as big as mutual funds by 2030? That's first. And which is the next disruptive class to enter alts?
So alts becoming as big as mutual funds is by 2030 is difficult because mutual funds itself is a growing asset class. So if you look at numbers at today at industry level at 35 lakh crores, because I'm counting now equity plus fixed income, but what would be interesting to compare is equity versus alternative or equity mutual funds versus alternative. So let's put quickly some mental maths. So that's 13 lakhs in say the next 4 to 5 years, it doubles, it becomes 26 lakhs. And right now we are at 5 lakhs in alts. That percentage could be as high as 50 to 60%. So maybe in the next 5 years, alternative should be around 15 lakh crores. That's my assessment.
Okay, cool. But an important
And the second question you asked was
new asset class.
So I think a lot of new business models itself. So it's not about new asset class. New models itself would be built on alternatives. So now let me give you an example. So there's an Israeli company called OneCrowd, which does a lot of angel. It's a platform on angel investing. Now, as here, when you look at Cat 1 license given for angel, that itself can transform into a OneCrowd here, right? So, or let's look at infra assets. So I'll not be surprised that one day AIF, which invests in infra assets, gets listed as an InvIT. So there'll be a lot of mutual funds, it's a lot of business models itself, which will get created on the AIF licenses. So that's my prediction, Jyoti.
Lovely. Thank you, Umang. Moving next, Leela, your question is, on scale of 1 to 5, how likely that regulator will continue taking consultative approach and not no adhocism towards bringing new regulations for the alts industry? How much would you rate?
That's a very sensitive one, but I'll give a 4 to the regulators because they have fiduciary duty towards the investors. They need to maintain a balance between them. So I'll go with a 4.
Right. That's a very good score. And I am sure the approach of consultation will continue.
Yes, absolutely.
Nikhil, another popular question for you. How long you see disruption will last in the consumer space? And how long disruption will last in the old space? 2 big questions, but a short answer would do.
No, I think disruption is just starting. You've seen no disruption happen in consumers for the last 5 decades. There are 15 companies which control almost 70% of consumer wallet till yesterday, and which is bizarre for a country like India. There are 2 companies who control 80-85% category share in almost every category that you look at, which is again bizarre. It's only because distribution was controlled and not because the brands were so super powerful. And I think that will get dismantled over a period of time. And that's obviously our belief that will happen. And that's the contra that we have to someone like Pramod, who obviously loves established businesses and so on. But I do believe that that's a huge disruption shall happen. It's the largest category play in this country. And I can't see how 2 players control 80-85% category share. That will possibly fall down to 40-50% over the next decade. And that share will be taken up by disruptors, which is the bet that you're taking. Second is that I think, unlike in the past, entrepreneurship quality is extremely different to what we've seen in the last 4-5 decades. Entrepreneurs today, unlike in the past, are not just thinkers, they are also execution guys. So that's a big difference that you're looking at. I also believe that, you know, consumers are moving, legacy companies are not. So while a lot of companies or legacy companies love to look at their market share gains by 100 bips or 200 bips plus minus every year, the the big loss that they think, I think they have, is that they're looking at market share loss. They are not looking at wallet share loss. Yeah, because the wallet share is moving into different categories. And that to me is where the salience of legacy will over a period of time become less relevant and less dominant. Yeah. And lastly, you know, I also think that entrepreneurship is today of a stage where I think the belief of entrepreneurs that if you die, die young, and thereby come back again, which was not the case in India for the last 5 decades. So I think you will see a lot more disruption happen in India. Time periods are elapsing or crunching really short, and thereby ability to make disproportionate returns have also crunched quite significantly. So I see this continuing quite non-linear over a period of time. The second was?
Just a second. Within the disruption, what will be the next disruption in the alts?
I don't know. You'll keep looking at it, right? You know, because frankly, what you think is virgin, it's almost overexploited, right? In every category, every business that you look at. So if it gets overexploited by default, the economics of the space gets destroyed first before it gets built up. So I think it's difficult to call what is going to be virgin, because I'm sure there are enough and more players looking at that categories and so on. But I do believe that, you know, there are a lot of businesses which are emitting, and I think the bigger sense is that, you know, brand loyalty is coming off, brand awareness is increasing disproportionate. And to me, that's the big disruption which will happen. And that will also create a lot of opportunities for players to become the more relevant player over the next decade. So I do see disruption happening in almost all spaces, a lot more in consumers, because they've seen no disruption for the last 5 decades. Yeah.
Wow, Nikhil, thank you so much. People thought that just beginning, launching this startups in the consumer space is the disruption in itself, but it's just the beginning. It's not a disruption yet. Pramod, it's an interesting question came from a lot of market investors and participants asking if on the scale of 1 to 5, I've just given a little nice shade to the question. On the scale of 1 to 5, how likely is Marcellus going to launch a CAD 2 or another CAD 3? So that's the question coming in.
Yeah, somehow I didn't see that coming, but yeah, tricky question. I wouldn't rule it out, but I won't be boring and sit on the fence by saying a 2.5 or a 3 either. I would say 4.
Okay. So that's a pretty bright chances, folks, whoever are asked that question to me. Now, this is the time when we actually come to the end of the lovely panel discussion. And I'm amazed with the spectrum of insights by each one of you, blended with global perspective, regulatory perspective. I think the discussion was simply marvelous. We have come to a point of vote of thanks. And I'm sure all of you know that putting this something like this together is a lot goes behind the scene. And I cannot thank enough the always super supportive trio team of IVCA, of Akriti, Shreya, Sumit, and under the leadership of Rajat, who has always been encouraging to keep such session. Of course, needless to say that I thank profusely all the participants that came here, Pramod, Nikhil, Umang, Leela, to share your experiences. It's so fantastic that we have so many takeaways. Another most spectacular, in fact, the most deserving of the compliment is a person who has literally put efforts, and industry has applauded his efforts towards making it all mainstream. On behalf of the participant and speaker, I would like to thank Tejesh Chitlangi, who continues to support such initiatives and is a torchbearer in himself. Towards the end, for the participants, I pulled up a very interesting quote from Harvard Business School professor Randolph Cohen, who speaks like this on the alternatives in his research. Both from globalization and from increasing ideas and technology, there are always new opportunities to make money. That's what makes the world of alternatives so exciting, because those new ideas for making money are almost always going to be couched in the language of alternative investments. Hence, wishing everybody out here working in the alternative segment that you guys are celebrities, you are doing a great job and doing all the heavy lifting to put India on the global map. Thank you so much, Umang, for your time. Nikhil, for your availability and time, and Pramod, wonderful always to listen to you. And Leela, thank you so much for changing the hats so swiftly between compliance, regulations, and legal. Wishing audiences much in advance Merry Christmas greetings and a blessed new year.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you all. Thanks.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure.